Om Sadashivasamaram Shankaracharya Madhyamam Asmayacharya Paryantam Vande Guru Paramparam Shruti Smriti Purananam Alayam Karunalayam Namami Bhagavatpadam Shankaram Gauka Shankaram Samasta Janakalyane Niratam Karunamayam Namami Chinmayam Devam Satguru Brahma Vidvaram Om Namo Bhagavate Vaivasvataya Mrityave Brahma Vidyacharyaya Nachiketa Secha. So, the first boon Nachiketa asked was that his father must become peaceful. So he said, Shanta Sankalpa Sumana Yathasya. So he says that let the agitations of the mind of my father, they become quiet. Now, the father must be having a lot of agitation because he has got angry. Then there is regret. Then he is imagining whether what will be the condition of my son there. Then there is guilt that I sent him away there. So he says, Shanta Sankalpa. Let his mind become peaceful. Why? And he did not ask only for his agitations to be removed, he asked for Sumana. Sumana means the mind becomes pure. For a spiritual seeker, this is very important. In Vedanta especially, if we want to know Brahman, purity of mind is important. It is not enough to handle the agitations, that okay, the mind is disturbed. Find some relief method and become quiet. That's not enough. Because the cause of agitation is a mind which is impure. So purity of mind, he asks, let my father have this purity of mind. Shanta Sankalpa Sumana Yathasya. And Vita Manyu. Let him be free from anger, meaning let him be free from attachment also. Ma avimrityo. Tvat prasrishtam ma avivade pratita. When I am sent by you from here, you must speak to me nicely. Avivade. You should recognize me, meaning nobody comes back from death. One only comes back in a new form. In the same form, if somebody comes back, then one will doubt who has come back. Maybe some other jivatma has come back in this body. One of the reasons why the body is disposed very soon as a person dies. One reason maybe is because it decomposes very fast, it should be finished, it should be born very fast. The other reason also is that there are various spirits which can use the body. So then, the father must recognize that I am the same Nachiketa, the same son of his who has come back, not some other entity. So, tvat prasrishtam ma vivade pratita, meaning he should recognize me and speak to me lovingly. Eta trayana prathamam varamani. I ask this as the first boon. And this shows the purity of mind of Nachiketa, that his heart is not having any raga and dvesha for his father. No attachment, no aversion. And he asks this. So, Yamaraj also gives. And how your father was before this whole episode happened, that way you will be and you will recognize it. Sukham Rastri Shaita Vitamanyo. You will be free from anger, you will sleep very peacefully. Dadrishavan Mrityu Mukhatra Muktam. Having seen you, having come back from the jaws of death, he will be fine, he will be at peace. Now comes the second boon. That what is the second boon that Nachiketa is asking? Before he asks the second boon, he gives a reason why he is asking the second, this as a second boon. Mantra number 12. Swarge lokena bhayam kinchana asti. Na tatra tvam na jalaya bibheti. Ubheti tva ashanaya pipase. Shokati go modate svargaloke.
Shokati go modate svargaloke.
So he says here, now see in the Bhashya you will always see, Bhashya literally means every word will be commented upon. So he will elaborate what is the meaning of each word. And after giving that meaning, he will give some additional points if he feels that is required. Some concept or some doubt may be created and that may be resolved. So basically it follows that method that every word will get elaborated. So if you see this commentary that you have, Shankaracharya's commentary, I'll just show you how it works. So Swarge Loke. So one of the ways to read a commentary is this. We should mark the mantras, the words of the mantra in the whole commentary. So Swarge Loke is a mantra. Words from the mantra. Now that Swarge Loke is explained as Rogadi Nimittam Bhayam Kinchana Kinchidapi Na Asti. So you see, Bhayam Kinchana, so Kinchana is explained as Kinchidapi and then Na Asti, it is not there. That is also the mantra word. Na Cha Tatra Tvam. So Cha is not a mantra word, but Na Tatra Tvam. You there, you are not there. So who is this you? Mrityo, you, O Lord, death. Sahasa prahavasyato. Meaning, effortlessly you take away the life here. There, you are not there. Meaning, in Hindi, you have done very nicely. वहाँ आपकी दाल नहीं गलती है. Here you see every day this loka is called Martya loka. Every moment death is happening here. So actually Yamaloka is where Yamaraj resides, but his function happens here. This is his office. That is his house. He works here. Everybody dies here. Tuck, 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 one by one, every minute. But in Swarga, he says, you are not there. Sahasa prabhavasyata. Jaraya yukta iha lokavat tatvato na vibheti kutaschit tatra. So this jaraya na vibheti, if you mark all these, then some of these words are Sanskrit. Simple meaning, so Shankaracharya won't elaborate. But some of the words he will need to elaborate, saying this is what this means. Kimcha ube ashanaya pipase tirtva. Now tirtva, so he says atikramya. Atikramya means to cross. In Swarga, one will cross this hunger and thirst. Shokam atitya gachati iti. So what is the significance of this crossing hunger and thirst? Shokam atitya goes beyond grief. Shokati Gasa. Manasena Dukhena Varjita. One is a bodily affliction, hunger and thirst is not there, and shoka is a mental affliction. This is manasena dukhena. Manasena dukhena, varjita, it is free from this. Modate, rishyati, means one enjoys. Swarga loke, divye. One of the other meanings of swarga is, words, synonyms of swarga is, divi, means in heaven. So divye. So this is how the bhashya is, every word. So when we see a bhashya, we should identify which are the words of the mantra, where they are written, and underline all of them. Then we will know for this word, what was the elaboration of Shankaracharya. So now what does this shloka have a deeper meaning here? Swarga is the state of existence where, a certain level of existence, which we desire even here, right now while we are living. What do we desire? It says, na bhayam kinchan asti. In swarga loka, there is no bhaya. So bhaya is at different levels. When we are attached to the body, that is the root cause of fear. And losing the body is one of the deepest fears. That's why we fear death. Because I think I am this, and when I die, then I will not have any existence. But that kind of a fear is not there in swarga. Why it is not there in swarga? Because the gross body is not there. One remains there in a astral body, in a subtler body, subtler form. This body made up of five elements is not there. And this body which is made up of five elements itself is a constant source of fear. You think about it. Suppose food is cooked or even uncooked, fruits, vegetables. If you leave it for a few days, what will happen? They will just rot. Automatically they will rot. Now that food is going inside this body. What will happen to this body? Because life is there, digestion, assimilation, all that is happening. But those, that the food that has the tendency to deteriorate, is there within? So the body is anyway going to deteriorate. And potential diseases are anyway there in this body. When our immunity system goes down, they will come up. That's why they say that this shariram is vyadhi mandiram. It's a abode of diseases. So it is anyway, the body itself is the cause of fear. In the world, there is so much of insecurity, competition, attachment, anger, exploitation, all that. So there is a lot of fear in life. But he says in swarga, there it is not there. In swarga, this fear is not there. One experiences more bliss there, in the sense that one goes there because of punya karma. And punya karma will always give good. It is the result of good actions. It's a karma phala. So the person will enjoy it. And hence he says, fear is not there in that place. Literally the word swarga means what? Ga means gachati. And swar means happiness. Going towards happiness. Swar sukham gachati iti swarga. That's the etymological meaning. So why does one desire swarga? Because one desires happiness. And one thinks that by going there, by being in a certain way, one will become happy. And there are means and methods available for that. That what kind of existence is there. So people desire swarga. Even his father was doing this whole agnividya for swarga only. So he understands this aspect. And it is said that these six afflictions which are there on this earth, they are not there in swarga. What are these six? They are called Shat Urmi, six waves. Shat Urmi, these are not there. What are the Shat Urmi? Janma and Mrityu. At the body level, birth and death. So he, as he says, na tatra tvam na jaraya vibhyati. You are not there. As death, you are not there. So birth and death is not there means what? Like the birth of this body and then the death of this body is there, it is not there like that. Person manifests because of karma, unmanifests because of karma. Appear and disappear. There is no residue left. Like the body, the residue is left here when we die. There they just appear in a, like the elements as though they come together. A person comes in subtle body, experiences, leaves and goes. There is no gross body there. So the birth of physical body and the birth death of physical body is not there. So Janma and Mrityu is not there at body level. Ashana, Pipase, that is not there at the pranic level. Hunger and thirst belong to the prana actually. The reason why we study in Tattva Bodha, the Pancha Kosha, etc. is to understand that part. That prana is not me. Prana is only the kosha. And the body goes through hunger and thirst because of this prana. So it is no birth, no death, one. No hunger and no thirst, no ashana, no pipasa, pranic level, and no shoka and no moha at the mental level, no grief. Because punya karma phala is what one is experiencing there. The result of punya karma will only be positive results. There is no grief there. Always happy. So here he says, shoka is not there, moha also is not there. Now remember, this is not complete freedom from shoka and moha. It is relative freedom from shoka and moha. As long as the jiva bhava exists, finitude exists, so long there will be shoka and moha. But the kind of grief that we have on this earth, that kind of grief is not there. Because attachments are not developed. You come there, you relate and you disappear. Oh yeah. There also, moha. The deepest level of moha is to consider myself as the body. That moha still remains there. But those other realms of those simpler levels of moha, those are not there. So what are those types of moha? Like putra moha or the thinking that this particular object will give me supreme happiness. That moha is not there. The clarity is there that this is relative, temporary happiness. That's all. So those types of moha, where the mind becomes very carried away very easily, those levels of moha will not be there. But the deepest level of moha will remain. I am this body, I am this jiva. Those levels of moha will remain. But even to be free from these other levels of moha, this is my son, this is my wife, this is my house, that kind of moha is not there. This is my money. Because one is mainly enjoying the karma phala. So these six, when they are not there, the human mind feels a lot of happiness. On one hand, these six afflictions are not there, and then it says, Ubhetitri ashanaya pipase, shokati go, beyond shoka one goes, and modate, one just rejoices. Modate swarga loke, one enjoys. No afflictions, no sorrow, no bodily pain, nothing. Only pure enjoyment. Like the advertisement, pure chocolate. Just throw. Subtle body is there, no? Atma to hone ki kabhi baat hai nahi. Atma to anyway sachidananda. That Atma's ananda is not here. You see the subtle body, the jiva is going there. So the jiva experiences the result of its own punya karma. And the jiva experiences a certain level of sense enjoyment, happiness, which it has desired and done that karma to experience. It is that level of enjoyment. Atma anyway doesn't go anywhere. There is no swarga for atma or narga for atma. So that too nobody is, that is not in question at all. The jiva, the individual goes there. The jivatma, dropping the physical body, that subtle body that goes there. And the subtle body feels itself as bound, limited, and going through pain, all this hunger, disease, grief, all that it goes through in this body, in this realm here. And it wants to be free from that. So Swarga is a higher realm of consciousness where it can experience that level of enjoyment, free from hunger, thirst, bodily afflictions, shokha, moha. One experience is that. Jivatma will never become the Atma. Atma has misunderstood itself to be the Jiva. No? Whole Vedanta is telling us that I am the infinite consciousness which has forgotten itself, identifying with one body. This whole process of Vedanta is to say I am not the body, to realize that I am the Brahman. No, so that's what it is. So Jivatma is not going to become Atma. Jivatma is already Atma. The Jiva Bhav which is there in that has to be dropped. Which is what we are doing through this whole process of sadhana, shravan, manan, nididhyas and meditation, all that. Mahavakya. This whole process is the false identification that we have got with the body has to go. There is no gap because Atma is not two different things are not there. Jivatma, one small little thing, Paramatma, one big little thing, and there is a big gap, and now this Jivatma has to become Paramatma. That's all our conditioning which we have to learn to drop. Because if I understand Vedanta clearly, where is the difference? There is no difference between a wave and an ocean. The difference is because I am seeing the form. Then I say big wave, small wave, but it's water only. Absolutely no difference. But if I keep seeing it only as a wave, or if I brand it as, okay, this Indian Ocean, the Pacific Ocean, the Atlantic Ocean, okay, that's a functional identity, but it is actually water. So the Jivatma which has gone there, that wants, while living here itself, one is, you just imagine, you know, that life is so short. In that short life, there is so much of pain at the body level, so much of, you know, raga, dvesha, klesha at the mental level. So human being wants freedom from all that. Absolute freedom, not everybody will desire directly. One wants relative freedom from this hunger and thirst and all that. So when I don't have to work, just imagine what a state it is. I don't have to work at all. Today my motivation to work is what? पापी पेट का सवाल है माय हंगर थर्स्ट आई हैव टू ईट ड्रिंक मिनिमम 3 to 4 टाइम्स अ डे आई हैव टू ईट हंगर ईच ऑफ देम इज अ पेन इफ यू गो टू सी हंगर इज अ पेन थर्स्ट वाटर इज नॉट देयर आई इमेजिन हाउ डेंजरस इट इज केप टाउन इज गोइंग टू गो आउट ऑफ वाटर. Bangalore is going to go out of water soon. It's on the list of top 6 cities in the world where water is not going to be there. What is the condition? Water not there? Drinking water not there? Hunger, thirst, they all are afflictions of the body. When hunger starts, a person becomes irritable, angry. And then what all will happen? Violence also can happen. Hunger is there, thirst is there, I have to work hard here. Even after working hard, sometimes I don't get proper result. Then there are people who constantly keep fighting with me. I keep fighting with them. How much is raga and dvesha and hunger and thirst? All that is not there in heaven. Then how do you enjoy in heaven? Here you have to work hard. If you want coffee, you have to walk. Or you have to go to the kitchen, make this coffee. There you have to do nothing. Coffee maker also is not required. Like nowadays there is a maker for every roti maker. So many makers are there. There is nothing. Users desire coffee. Is there? By sankalpa alone. Even to here also, the enjoyment is very difficult. Hard work one has to do to enjoy. If I eat a cake, the tongue will only experience the pleasure. But it has to go inside the body, through the stomach, into the intestines. Digestion has to happen properly, then assimilation, absorption, all that has to happen. Because the body is there. In that way, there is no body. So how do you consume coffee? Through smell. And more importantly, the people there down on the earth, when they do yajna, no? Then through the mantra and through the ahutis, one experiences great peace. That's why the Gita says, Devan bhavayatanina te deva bhavayatva. You propitiate the devatas with your ahutis and they will bless you with what you want. Because they have subtler powers, devatas. Parasparam bhavayanta shreya parma vapsyatha. Mutually cooperating with each other, attain the highest. So this Swarga Loka is a subtle realm of existence where the power of sankalpa works. And hence everybody wants to go to that Swarga Loka. And Nachiketa also asks, because his father also in one way has to understand, because his father won't get Swarga. Even he has compromised with his yajna, Swarga is not possible for him today. Because the ritual is not done appropriately. If only if it is done properly, the proper karma phalam, which is desired, will come. It is not done properly, so how will he get it? So one is that he is asking this boon for father, other is he is also asking this boon for the society. So now see the next one, where he asks the boon. This one was to say that why Swarga is important. And why people ask for Swarga. Because between this sorrow in this world and absolute immortality, the relative state of bliss, happiness, where these sorrows are not there, like the deep sleep state, is not a positive state of bliss of the Atma, but it is absence of the agitations. This agitation doesn't exist. I always give that example of a very quiet, simple, introvert child versus a very naughty child and a very hyperactive. Both of them, when they sleep, they look like angels. So nice. I sadly sleep. But when this second fellow gets up, finished, the whole house will bring down. Till he's sleeping, everybody is happy in the house. So nice. It's like that. The agitations of this world are not there in that state. But that is not absolute bliss. One of the reasons why this Swarga is described in the Upanishad also is to tell us that it is limited. Why should one desire that when there is an opportunity for absolute truth, immortality? But now, one cannot make somebody want that absolute truth by force. You know, no, drop Swarga, get that only. If one doesn't mature enough to transcend this identification or this craving, it will not be possible. So, certain things one has to go through. Certain things one can imagine, understand, figure out, is this even worth it, and think it out and let it go. So in the earlier days, they used to do all these rituals by which their desire will be go to Swarga. Purva Mimamsa and Uttara Mimamsa is part of the Veda. Purva Mimamsa is all Karma Kanda. And the main objective of Karma Kanda is go to hell. Enjoy the life there and come back. There is no higher level of immortality, oneness, nothing. And in fact, in their thinking, the entire Upanishads are useless. Because there is no result of this. For them, the result is what? If any mantra is there in the Upanishad, will it help me to do a ritual and go to heaven? If it is helping me to do that, it is useful. If it is not helping me to do that, it is useless. Kamna yasya kriyarthatvat. That's the mantra. That's the mindset. That if a mantra is there, it has to lead to some kriya, some karma, and that karma will lead to heaven. So a lot of emphasis on going to heaven. Gurudev used to tell us it's an emphasis on a better standard of living, where I don't have to work hard. Are we not doing that? Nowadays, for everything there is something or the other. We don't have to do anything. Before we go into the house, sitting in our car, we can control our AC, remote, our light, fan, TV, everything from the car only. So I don't have to even go and switch on the AC. I don't have to do nothing. That is heaven only, where I don't have to work hard. Things happen automatically. So everyone desires that. So Nachiketa, when he is asking this, he is asking for two purposes. One is, his father also, he has to go and tell him again how to do this Agnividya so that he will get in heaven. Another is, he will teach it to the society also. Because he is learning it directly from Yamanaj. So he asks that as the boon. That is the next mantra, 13th one. Sattvam agnim svarga madhye shimrityo. Prabruhitam shraddhanaya mahyam. Svarga loka amritatvam bhajante. Etat vitiye navrine varena. This is Singapore. Evam guna vishishtasya svarga lokasya prapti sadhana bhutam. Evam guna vishishtasya means what was said in the earlier mantra. The svarga is having all these characteristics of freedom from hunger, thirst, grief, old age, disease. At the body level that also happens. No old age, no disease, no death. So human body goes through six vikars. Asti, jayate, vardhate, viparinamate, apakshiyate, pranashyate. That is what we saw. It is conceived, then it is born, then it grows, then it changes. Asti, jayate, vardhate, viparinamate. Apakshiyate, it slowly starts decaying, vinashyate. It becomes old and then dies. Now in that Janma is not there. Apakshiyate is not there. Mrityu is not there. Asti also, it is there, existence is there, that jiva exists. So three vikars only it goes. In the physical level, six vikars it goes. And so with this kind of qualification or qualities that are there in heaven, such a heaven people would want to go to. So he said, evam guna vishishtasya svarga lokasya prapti sadhana bhutam. How to go there? That sadhana you have to tell me. See, agnim. So now agnim is the word of the mantra. Sattvam, mantra. Mrityu, who is this Tvam? Tvam is Mrityu, means O Lord Yama. Adhyeshi, smarasi janasi iti artha. You please remember and tell me this vidya. He Mrityo, O Lord Death, Yatastvam Prabruhi Kathaya, please tell me, Shraddhanaya Shraddhavate Makhyam Swargarjinaha. He says, you please tell me because I am full of faith. Because one important aspect is faith plays a crucial role here. In the things which are not perceptible by the senses, what is the Pramana? Shastra is the Pramana. Veda is the Pramana. And we are very strange, you know, as today we become so-called scientific minded. But even in science, is it not true? What is not perceptible by the senses, what is our Pramana for it? At the level of science, is the books of science. Has any of us seen Big Bang? Will any of us ever see Big Bang? It is not possible. But we believe. What is the Pramana? We have derived that conclusion because of analyzing some effects in the world and then coming to certain conclusion. Some scientist has thought about it and then he propagated that theory and then other people have supported it and they feel it is possible and logical and then they have gone ahead with that. So even in science it happens like that. Same thing in spiritual life. The Shastra is the Pramana. So he says, I am filled with Shraddha. That there is a Swarga Loka. Majority in today's world doesn't even believe that there is a Swarga Loka. And if you tell them that there is a Swarga Loka, they will say, oh, you will keep getting beliefs. But it is very strange that is. Earth exists, but Swarga doesn't exist. Why? Because Earth is perceptible by these eyes. And if I develop those subtle vision through the performance of the rituals, etc., I will be able to see, experience Swarga also. Devatas also, one can have darshan of the devatas. The phenomenal forces, they exist. But our mind doesn't believe on that. So, Shraddha is a very, very important aspect. It is not all subjective level. We always should remember this whole creation has three levels. Adi Daivik level, Adi Bhautik level, Adhyatmik level. We say Shanti three times for this only. So that let there be no obstacles from the world outside, from the cosmic forces, from the beings around us and from subjective agitations. So we say Shanti, Shanti, Shanti. Adi Daivik, Adi Bhautik, Adhyatmik level, let there be Shanti. So Adi Daivik level is what? Heaven as a realm of existence. Realm of consciousness exists. And it has certain criteria that who can go there. And how to go there? Those means are written in the Veda. What is the condition in the heaven? That also is given as we just saw. What you saw in one mantra, Swargya Lokena Bhayam Kincha Nasti and all that, elaborate descriptions are given in the Vedas and in the Puranas that what is the state of heaven and why people desire that and they go there. So, as a realm of consciousness, it exists. There is Adi Daivik level. Adi Bhautik level is what is heaven. When there is harmony in the society, people live with love and happiness, mutual sharing, cooperating, understanding, then there is heaven at the society level. Adi Bhautik level. When we live in harmony with the environment, there is mutual cooperation, then there is heaven. And what is hell? When this cooperation is not there, rigidity, fighting, violence, then that is hell. Hell and heaven, as planes of existence, they exist. And adhyatmic level is mind which is peaceful is heaven. Mind which is disturbed is hell. Now these three levels, they exist. Even in the Gita, in chapter, Bhagavan is asked by Arjuna, kimcha brahma kim adhyatmam kim karma purushottamam adhi daivam cha kim proktam adhi yajnam kim uchyate. He asks, what is adhi daiva, what is adhyatma, what is adhibhuta? So these three levels, they are existing. And heaven as a realm of consciousness exists. We should know, understand that part. As dream as a realm of consciousness exists, like that there is a realm of consciousness called heaven. And it has its own rules, like who is a loka. Sewer loka is called a swarga. And bhuloka has rules. Body here is made up of five elements. Gross body we have here. In heaven there is no gross body, there is a subtle body. So just a different method of perception there. The jiva experiences certain things. So one should know this very clearly. So he says that this, I have faith that there is a heaven. And that what you say also, I have faith that by following that I can go to heaven, people can go to heaven. So he says, Mahyam Swarga Chinna. Yena Agnina Chitena Swarga Lokaha Swargo Loko Yeshamke Swarga Lokaha Yajamanaha. So Swarga Loka Bhajante Amritatvam Bhajante means Swarga Lokaha, it means the people who desire Swarga. Swarga Loka is the level, is the heaven. Swarga Lokaha meaning those people who desire heaven. And why do they desire heaven? Amritatvam. Amaranatam Devatvam. See, this is important. The word Devatvam. This is how commentary clarifies. Amritatvam here is not absolute immortality or knowledge of the self. Amritatvam here is relative freedom from mrityu. Meaning, this body is birth, body is death, body is afflictions, disease, all that is not there. So there is much more peace. Just imagine that state. Here to every second day the body has some problem. If every second day it has a problem, that is still manageable. Every day it has a problem. Something or little goes on. Head is paining and neck is paining and back is paining and cold is there and cough is there and continuously it's Yadi Mandira. That is not there. And there is relative immortality also because the number of years that one lives there compared to human life is much more there. Our one whole year is equal to one day. So our 80 years is what? 100 years is what? Just 100 days. So there the lifespan is much more. But it is devatvam. It is relative immortality. And what does he say here? Praknumanti tadetad agni vijnanam vitiyena varena vrine. He said that agni vidya, that ritual by which I can go to heaven, that is the boon which I am asking with this second. That is what I want as a second boon. Please teach me that knowledge by which I will go to heaven. Now if this knowledge is available in the Veda, why is he asking this knowledge? He is asking it from Lord Yama directly. He says, you are the knower of this. So you please teach me this directly. That how to go, what type of ritual we should do, and how do I do it. Especially when my father has done the compromise, I will have to go and teach him that. So you please tell me. So Yavraj then he starts telling him that how this has to be done. Now one important thing here is, remember, Nachiketa himself doesn't want to go to heaven. Because if he himself wanted to go to heaven, then the third boon he will not ask. And he would have fallen for all the temptations of heaven that Yavraj gives him. So Nachiketa is a Uttam Adhikari, he does not want for himself. First boon he asked for his father, second boon he asked for the society. That mind alone has that jignyasa to know the truth. Mamukshitvam to know the truth. Because that mind is not caught in any raga, any vesha, it has purity, it has selflessness. So he goes seeking that supreme Brahma Vidya. Because ego is has become so thin. Other aspect also here is that when we want to serve the society, we should find what is the need of the society And if it is in my swadharma to do it, I must do that. So, this applies to anybody, even a human being. If I want to serve somebody, I should find out what that person needs and fulfill that need of that person. I should not do whatever I feel like doing. Suppose that person wants a certain thing to be done, then one should help that person with that, not whatever one feels like doing. Suppose somebody says, I need help in administrative work, can you please come and help? And if I am able to do that, I should go and help there. And if the person says, no, I don't want any other type of help, just give me this much, that is enough, then one should follow that. But many times one will do what one wants to do, not what the other person wants actually. So even as a society, if the society is at a level where they want success, name, fame, and everybody will be at different levels, not everybody wants Brahma Vidya straight away. So to tell the society those aspects, that how they can attain success, how they can be harmonious in relationships, how there can be peace of mind, there is nothing wrong in that. And Nachiketa himself is doing that, saying that this is what the need of the society is, because if they go through that, then they will see the limitation of it and grow out of it. There is a path of growing, evolution. Nobody will directly jump to the 20th step. One has to go through the intermediate steps. So Nachiketa is asking this not because he wants it. Nachiketa is asking this because in society there is a demand for it, there is a need for it. So if you want to know how to go to heaven, come in the next month.
Which is a land project that only take birth on this material. So what we are trying to study this Vedanta, it reduces our desire, it reduces the high of the religion, and the more and more we can contemplate and meditate on the Supreme. Is this the way that we can create birth on this material?
See, as I told you, there are three levels. The process that you are mentioning is for your internal method of evolution to realize the Supreme Bliss. That is beyond heaven. If the whole society starts following that, then of course at Adi Bhautik level there will be Swarga, where people will understand this knowledge of selflessness, service, cooperation, sacrifice, all that, which is what the ritual, etc., is also meant to inculcate in the individual. So if in the society that happens, then at Adi Bhautik level there will be a Swarga. So if the knowledge is spread to people, people start living by that, which is what the attempt is, no? That all the great masters have come and they are trying to share this knowledge, not to create Swarga as a sense of enjoyment, but Swarga as a happy place where harmoniously people exist, not with violence and fighting and stress and all that. For them the knowledge is to be given, to be shared. And people have to live that. Today I am ending early because there is a class at 9:30, I have to be at Anjali. So I will turn, I have to be very quick. March 12 to 16, the next set of dates is 12 to 16 March. And April is 9 to 13. May is 14 to 18. Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamadachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Hari Om Shri Guru Namah.